We've reached Friday of the third week of our New Testament by Pentecost challenge. I hope you are finding it increasingly easy to keep up and getting into a reading rhythm, and I hope that you're giving yourself plenty of grace if not. This isn't about a deadline. It's about immersing ourselves in the Scriptures. Today we focus on Jesus' ministry as recorded by Matthew in chapters 19 through 25. Today I want to focus a bit more on the fivefold structure I mentioned in the first introduction of Matthew. Borg writes, in between the stories of Jesus' birth in chapters 1 and 2 and his final days in chapters 26 through 28, the body of Matthew's gospel has five blocks or sections of material, as scholars have long noted. Each combines narrative and teaching and ends with a distinctive formula. It is, now when Jesus had finished whatever it was he was doing. See chapter 7, verse 28, 11:1, 13:53, 19:1, and 26:1 for uses of that formula. This fivefold structure reflects the five books of Torah and perhaps the traditional division of the Psalms into five collections. Where Torah is the foundational document of Judaism, Matthew is presenting a new foundational document for a new understanding of God's revelation. God leads the people out of slavery into a new community and gives law by which it is to live. If this suggestion of an approach to Matthew interests you, Borg and Cresson's book The First Christmas explores it in some detail. Key themes in today's readings are righteousness and Jesus' authority. Note that despite being the most frequent adversaries, it's likely that Jesus was viewed as a Pharisee by many, their heated conflicts being basically brother squabble or an inter-party debate, where the outrages come from violations of expected agreement. It might be easy to miss the importance of the claim in chapter 24, verse 35, Jesus' teaching, his words, are equated with Torah. Again, as with many events in chapter 14 and 17, the claim here is that Jesus is equal with God. We, of course, now take that for granted, but imagine how that claim sounded to listeners in the first century. John Wesley, like all Christians, recognizes that the Lord is our righteousness. We are acceptable to God not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus did for us. It is Christ's righteousness, but it's also now ours. Together, these constitute our acceptance before God. Wesley also insists that God's gracious acceptance of us both enables and requires cultivation of inner righteousness through participation in the means of grace and acts of personal and social piety. Responding to God's grace, our distorted natural, moral, and political or social image is being restored to what God intended us to be. And ultimately, for Wesley, it was possible for us to become perfectly human. That's not without flaw, but living in perfect love and full relationship with God and neighbor. Blessings on your reading.